We need a new understanding of the economic theory of income, employment and money, but one that's heavily technologically intensive. You know, what is the technological theory of income, employment and money? Because the thing that I think is missing in most economic models is a deeper understanding of the production matrix, you know, of exactly what's happening there in terms of output and employment. And as you also say, I mean, this idea that all policies seem to be oriented towards high wage work. And, you know, like the Labour Party in the UK, the answer apparently is high wage work. Well, this would be great if that were an option. The thing that we have to question, I'm not saying that it's definitively so, but the thing that we have to question is, with more and more automation, is high wage work going to be sufficiently available to meet the income needs of the population? I personally doubt it. So therefore, to have political policies which talk about nothing other than work, and even to do with increased life expectancy, the answer in the UK has been to increase the retirement age. In my view, a crazy answer. So you've now got people, you know, 75, 80, staying in the place of work rather than enjoying their retirement because the government doesn't want to accept the social cost. It wants to hope that somehow or other this can be funded in the employment sector. And frankly, it can't. We need to have a greater, which is what this conference is partly about, a greater understanding of social welfare funded socially.
Can I raise the question of a GDP? Because I was very pleased that you made some reservations when you mentioned GDP. So, I think it's the MMT which talks about the national account. And when I have been looking at ways of making sense of all unpaid, invisible work, and looked at what they are doing in OECD and others to measure it, I think there should be some place where you can where this is collected, and would that be the national account surveys?
Frankly, I don't know. I mean, at the moment, I think
we have a limited measure, but it does at least measure whether food and clothing and housing are getting to people. But you're absolutely right. It's by no means a comprehensive measure of welfare or of well-being. Any other questions or...?
I have a question. You put against high-wage jobs and bullshit jobs, was it? What, am I right?
Yeah.
So how do you define bullshit jobs?
Well, this was... his name escaped me at the moment. He died recently, sadly.
David Gray.
Yeah. Who defined... quote, bullshit jobs. Ultimately it seems to me that it comes back to a measure of job satisfaction by the job holder. So it's not up to me to say somebody's job is mega and elite and somebody else's is bullshit. The idea that people want work and more work, that's clearly not true. I mean, I remember working in a factory and at 4 o'clock in the afternoon when it finished, they weren't all hanging around till 5 o'clock or 6 o'clock, you know, 4 o'clock, woo! It's a sort of mad rush. Although there are exceptions to that, the workaholics, of course. I mean, well, there's one guy, I worked for Rolls-Royce Aero Engines, and there's one manager who would famously stay till the end. And he would walk along watching the car park, and only when the last executive car had gone would he then go. So, you know, people have all sorts of mixed personal responses to their place of work, don't they?
Mm.
But if job satisfaction...
That's what we need to be responding to. And if you've got in-work poverty, then clearly you know the system is not valuing that work. Otherwise, why is it not paying sufficient for somebody to live on? So, I mean, I'm not against work. Of course I'm not, because I think that creative activity is kind of somehow part of the human ontology. You know, we like to and want to be involved in creative activity. But the way that we have developed to define that as this job thing, and this rather fixed stereotype, and even this thing about the precarity. I mean, it's interesting that some of my colleagues who are most critical of the precarious employment tell me that their kids, who are early 20s, love it. You know, they can do a gig in the evening, And I'm involved as a chair of a business in Bristol, happens to be in the care sector, and in this business we get a lot of young people coming along actually want 0 hours contract. We say, no way, we don't. We want people who will commit to come and do the job. And they want 0 hours because they live at home with their parents and they can, you know, they want to be able to party and not come on a particular day. So there are some people who seem to want a very flexible mode of employment. Now, if the new paradigm can accommodate that and say, okay, nobody should force, you know, 0 hour contracts, but if you want to that mixed mode, then here's a way by UBI in which you can choose. I think we should be, you know, open-minded and flexible and kind of examine options rather than shutting them down as immediately counter-political.
Yes, I'm Albert Sigurdsson from Iceland, the fourth person from Iceland here today who's speaking. I've been to several of these conferences on UBI and mostly here in the Nordic countries, and I'm always learning more and more, but what I just take from all of these, and particularly now today when we have had a discussion about how we can afford it, is that there are many ways of calculating how we can afford a UBI in different countries, and maybe that would be the conclusion that different countries need their different solutions how to establish this. So in Iceland we have several problems that may not occur so easily or are different from other countries in some practical respects, although economists might see it always the same kind of classifications. So I would just suggest that for each country there should be some kind of plan. The goal should be the same, some kind of, let's call it utopian society or UBI society. But for instance, like Haldur said here earlier, UBI is not the only thing that needs to be changed. There are many other things, that, like I think you said, it's a structural problem, not a behavioral problem. So there are many structures that need to be rearranged. For instance, in Iceland, we have a housing market that is majority of housing is privately owned. There is almost no rental market. So in Iceland, another problem besides UBI would be to establish more choices in housing. Everybody needs a house in Iceland. It's cold and all that. So there are several issues to be handled apart, you know, with UBI, and also in, like Haldur also said, we have personal tax deduction for everybody who is working in Iceland or has an income, and we would like to build on that. So in a way, UBI could be both a goal, but it's the way there would be some kind of steps, maybe a ladder. And the first step on the Icelandic ladder would be to build on this personal tax dividend or and to increase it and so on, and to give it to people who are not having income, like students and so on. So, but in Denmark, Sweden, Finland, UK, there could be other steps, but the goal should be the same, some kind of society where corporations are not able, or the powerful are not able to manipulate everybody around them, everybody around them. So that would be the snakes, since I was talking about the ladder. So it could be a snakes and ladders game, really. But yeah, but mainly I was going to say that there will be different paths towards this goal in different countries. We should talk together, learn about all the possibilities, but also accept that the steps will be different for different countries. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much. I mean, I visited your lovely country for the first time in my life about a month ago, and enjoyed it greatly, including a lovely concert at your amazing concert hall. It was great. I think 1,600 people at a concert from a population of about 200,000 was amazing. So it's a lovely place.
They were probably homeless. They were probably homeless.
And they didn't look it. Thank you. But I do agree. I mean, I think that these proposals should be tailored and specific to each situation. They should be situation specific. So, I mean, for example, in China, there's a huge case for basic income. Why? When the Chinese, my colleagues in China say, but we've got 1.4 billion population, how are we going to get the basic income to them? I said, because at the moment, you're supplying 7 billion people worldwide with virtually every manufactured product. If you can provide for 7 billion, you can certainly provide for your own 1.4 billion. So as you know, I mean, for example, in the USA, consumer is being supplied by Chinese products with furniture, with clothing, and so on, and that's funded by the Chinese government buying US Treasury bonds to complete the circuit. Why not instead put the same money into a Chinese UBI and allow the Chinese population to buy the furniture and clothing that they produce themselves? So that's the situation specific. Another friend of mine is also working in post-conflict situations in Syria and Iraq. She is herself Syrian and working at the University of Vienna. And she was telling me that in Syria, of course, we don't support the regime there, but there are people there. In terms of food, they're currently issuing local currency, but, quote, backing it up by loans from Iran and Russia. So the question there is, why do you need the loans from Iran and Russia? Only because you're insisting on money creation must be debt. So it then depends what the supply chain of the food is and how you then get a supply chain which is more local to the local economy and so on. And talking with colleagues in Malaysia and Vietnam, because we're planning a conference in Southeast Asia early next year, and both of them are subject to a debt-to-GDP constraint of 55%. But then they say, when you look at every developed country, it's 100%. So there's a constraint upon their ability to have a higher standard of living because of this constraint. So there, again, a rather different solution that eases that constraint might be the first step. But I also agree with you that whatever the end goal of the model is, we should proceed stepwise, which I think is what you're saying. You add to your work dividend and you watch the result. And if the result looks favourable, then of course you can increase. If it generates unexpected difficulty, then you've got to think again. But, you know, a piecemeal reform in the direction that you're saying, but one that is situation-specific and has analysed the supply chains in the real economy, is the way to go.
So, how do you look at the role of the World Bank and International Monetary Fund and, of course, the EU too, but for countries in economic development, their external debt and so on? Do you see any light at the end of the tunnel there?
Well, yes, I do, in that the World Bank have recently been producing papers on basic income. If you go to my ubi.org website, on the books page, you'll find a review of the latest World Bank paper on basic income. And so that community is also beginning to think it through. Now, as you say, how does this apply to a developing economy? The answer has always, in my view, got to refer back to the production side of the economy. If we can deliver income to people, which we easily can, there's no problem producing money. Can we produce the bread? Can we produce the clothes? Can we produce the housing? And, you know, what is the supply side looking like? And can that supply side be expected to respond to growth? Because when we're talking about alleviating poverty, we are talking about growth. That's just definitionally got to be the case. And if we want to lift people out of poverty, as China has done, is there the supply chain there that will respond to aggregate demand funding from a basic income? And that has got to be what's very specific to each country situation. Or will it necessarily suck in imports because there will never be the local manufacturing capability? And if so, what's the effect on exchange rates and so on? So they've got to be modelled. But yes, I think that the World Bank
I don't know so much about the IMF, but World Bank is certainly thinking about both that and the definition of money not as debt. Biagio, what's the story?
What about there's a lot of informal economy in the developing economies, and it was in relation to the GDP, because I think it was originally created also to take account of the poor countries' loan burden, and because a big part of the economy is informal. Isn't that really to a disadvantage of these countries? Seen from a sort of IMF, World Bank point of view.
Well, you're right. That I mean, in these informal countries, in these developing countries, and I have worked in several of them, there is a big informal sector. That's absolutely correct. But how far that informal sector would grow if you made more income available to the consumer, and whether the informal economy can respond with production and output needs to be evaluated in each situation. But how you then, as if you were the government, how you then propose to manage the economy if you keep accepting that a large part of it is informal and not yielding any tax revenues and so on, that's problematic. As I said earlier, I can't pretend to be a guru and answer every question. I don't necessarily know.
There is actually, we have a question from our YouTube stream. It's not directed at anyone per se, but I'd like to hear your two cents, Geoff.